Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to come before you. And it's a special day. It's Palm Sunday, Lord. And so we just want to celebrate you and all that you are and the King that you are and the Savior that you are. And we just thank you for everything you've done for us and for all the blessings you put in our lives. Guide us now as we get into your word and we learn some more about you and we hear some stories and we try to grow together closer to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Tonight's topic is kind of an interesting one. It's about how does a good God and suffering line up? You know, how can bad things happen if there's a good God who's all-powerful and does this stuff? And when I think about suffering and God, there's no one I think about more when I think about suffering than my brother. And if you've met my brother, he's done some suffering in his life for God. Check this out.
Okay, push the button.
I kill you.
I thought you were kidding. You slapped me, you hit me with a dinosaur, a pillow, ran into a door, punched, hit with a blue thing, a bat, dinosaur again,
quit,
door, kind of, bat, you really like the bat.
Hitting, hurting, punch, out.
A water balloon, a shovel, wet towel, a zucchini, I got hit by a pastor, and a Bible.
We did
Thank
this
you for your
too.
Continued support.
He found himself thrust into a career as a motivational speaker for a local junior high.
Is no one wants to see your ugly face?
No, no, Eric!
Come here!
Got the kind that lasts forever. We're in this love together, and like berries on the vine, it gets sweeter all the time.
So that's my brother. One time we tried to hit him with a car, but he got away. So to me, that pretty much sums up suffering for God. So I think I'm done now, right?
You're done.
Sam, I don't know if you can improve on that.
I can't. I absolutely can't. That was great, though. Thank you.
Cheer for God's hacky sack.
Yeah. I think about all the fun times that we've had with Tim over the years and beating up on him and using him to illustrate all these great things. And I think you're right, Rob. I think that suffering and kind of using Tim as an example of suffering, you know. And yeah. And there must be a little bit of that older brother thing, you know, where you actually get to beat him up for fun, you know, and for a good cause. Oh, that's great. That's great. Well, let's say a prayer and just ask God's blessing right now. Dear Lord, as we talk about suffering, I just pray that you would speak to us. Lord, because I know I've experienced suffering in my life. I know that as I look around this room and I look at some of the people here and I know some of their stories, and I know that some of these people have experienced suffering. And so, Lord, I just pray right now that as we talk about this, that ultimately we would understand more about you and what you're doing, Lord Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. Okay, so I need a volunteer right off the bat, okay? I need a volunteer. You can come on up. I saw your hand go up first. Now, okay, first let me ask you. You're wearing some kind of nice stuff. Do you mind getting disastertized? He's looking like he's not quite sure. Are you sure? Okay, come on up. Come on up. Okay. How many of you guys like Coke? Anybody here love Coke? Okay, yeah, I love Coke too. And Coke's like really, really, really good, right? Do you really like Coke? Do you like Coke like all over you? Okay, so what I want you to do is I want you to open up that can right there. No. Okay. Now, are you sure you want to open up the can? Okay, after I do this, are you sure that you want to open up this can? You're positive. You like Coke that much? Are you positive? You want to see what happens? Right here, right now? Should we let him see what happens? Okay, let me tell you something here. You know what? This can, I just shook this can up really hard, okay? Now, I don't know if you can hear this, but there's all kind of fizzing going on in there. And actually now this can is so hard that the moment you open up this can, what do you think is going to happen? It's going to go everywhere. Do you want this can to go everywhere? No. Okay, that's kind of what I actually was thinking, that you were going to, you know. And, you know, I think about this can, and we are going to open up this can in just a second, okay? But I think about this can, and have any of you guys ever felt like God is just totally shaking your world up, and you are going through some stuff, and you're like, what in the world is going on, God? Anybody ever felt like that? Anybody ever felt like that? Okay, so what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to turn to your neighbor, and I'd like you to tell your neighbor, like, something that you've gone through or some kind of hard thing that you've gone through where you experienced this and you were like, God, what in the world are you doing? Some kind of maybe suffering, some kind of hurt, some kind of pain. Just turn and talk to your neighbor and just tell him right now, okay? Have you ever gone through any kind of painful experience?
Yeah.
What have you gone through? Oh, really? Okay. Do you mind sharing that to these people? Okay, that sounds good. And by the way, what's your name?
Carson.
And how old are you, Carson?
9.
You're 9. I'm glad you came up here. Okay, so tell me, what are some of the things that you guys have experienced? What are some tough things that you guys have experienced out here? Yes. I saw your hand go up right away. This is going to explode. Yeah, this is going to explode. Yeah. What's a tough thing that you've experienced? Addictions. Yeah, addictions, tough things. Yes, back there. What was that? Getting splashed? Oh, getting slapped. Yeah, that would be tough too. Yep, that would be tough. Yeah. Okay, anybody else? Anybody else? Yeah. Little brothers. Little brothers? And they just really cause a lot of damage? Okay, little brothers, yeah. Okay, yes. Little sisters, okay, that's rough, okay. How many of you guys have ever experienced the death of somebody that you loved? Okay. How many of you guys have ever experienced a sickness of either that you've experienced or that somebody else has experienced in your family? Okay, a lot of hands. How many of you guys have ever been, either your parents got divorced, or you've been part of a divorce, or a tear-up, or something like that? Anybody ever experienced that? Okay, there's quite a few hands there. Anybody ever experienced, like, abandonment, or somebody that you really loved just kind of, like, totally abandoned you and left and went somewhere else, or did maybe they died or something like that? Yeah. How many of you guys have ever experienced, like, the betrayal of a friend or somebody saying something that was hurtful about you? Anybody experienced that? Okay, so I would almost say that everybody in this room has experienced some type of suffering in the past. And let me ask you this. How many of you guys are experiencing some suffering right now? Anybody here experiencing some suffering right now? Okay, I would actually say that that's probably half the room. Half the room. And all of us at some point have experienced some suffering or some tough things, right? And so you've experienced this kind of like shaking and your life just kind of says, God, what in the world is going on, right? Why am I experiencing this? And have any of you guys ever had it like, it builds up and it builds up, and then you open up the can, and what happens? Has anybody out here ever just had like that rage kind of like build up and that being fed up with this, and all of a sudden you just like explode? And just like, it's usually it's like the small thing, right, that kind of happens? Well, I experienced a little bit of that on Sunday night, okay? So on Sunday, we had some kids out to our house, and they were riding four-wheelers at our place, and it was awesome. But one of the four-wheelers broke down, so I was a little bit worried about that. And then I was playing Ultimate Frisbee with a bunch of kids on guys' night, and one of the kids inadvertently, as he was getting ready to throw the Frisbee, I went there to hit it, and it totally nailed me in my eye, okay? And so I was getting, you know, so that kind of like gave me a downer, right? And then so I had decided, okay, I just better leave because I'm not making any more friends. You know, things are just not going all that well. And so I went and I got to my vehicle and I saw a little note that said, Sam, we're really sorry about your window. And I open up my door and there is glass everywhere, right? There's glass everywhere. And there's like some caution tape like put on the window and stuff like that, or what was left of the window. And there's like shards of glass like sticking out, you know, of the where the window rolls up. And a bunch of people had run over there and were around me. And I remember looking over at this glass and thinking, I'm not going to turn, and I'm definitely not going to swear. But inside, I can tell you what, there was this rage like building up in me, and I was about ready to explode, right? And then I found out that it was a prank. So thank you, Jeff and Doug and whoever else was part of that prank, because you did get me. But when your life is shaken up like this, and you open it, bad things happen, don't they? But here's the thing. What God wants to do in our life is God wants to say, you know what? Here's the shaking that happens. But I want to remind you of my goodness. I want you to remind you that I'm here. I want to remind you that no matter what, I will never leave you or forsake you. No matter what you're facing, that I am still here. Now go ahead and open up that can. There you go. That's yours. And you can take this one too. Let's give this guy a hand for coming up here and being part of this. So last Sunday for guys' night, we had Donovan come up and he shared his story with us. And you guys are going to hear Donovan's story in just a moment. But this is a story where God has taken Donovan through some really crazy things in his life. And I thought it was so powerful on Sunday night and so amazing to hear how God works through the midst of suffering, through the midst of pain, to ultimately bring us to himself. And so you're going to hear this story. And Andrew is going to come up and he's going to interview Donovan. And they're just going to share this story and kind of Donovan's history.
Thank you guys for being here. Last week I had the privilege of interviewing Donovan and just hearing his story, hearing his life, hearing his testimony. I was so empowered to hear some of that I just amazing how we had the ability to share it at Guys Night. And so thanks, Donovan, for being here.
Thank you.
But I guess the first thing, question I want to ask you is, where are you from? Where were you born? What's your birth date?
I was born in Bogota, South America, the country of Colombia. Mm-hmm. And my birth date is January 30th, 1976.
Okay.
Approximately.
Approximately. Yeah. Approximately. What do you mean by approximately?
Because my birth, I was abandoned and taken to an orphanage after a few weeks of stay in the hospital where I was really malnourished. And so they don't know my exact birth date, I guess.
Gotcha. And I remember you saying you don't know your birth parents, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Would you feel free sharing what happened with that, or what did they do with you? What did your birth parents do with you? Did they give you right to the orphanage?
No, I was left at a dumpster.
Uh-huh.
And there was a guy walking by that happened to be a nurse, and he heard me crying, and he took me to his local hospital where he worked. And then I spent, I think, about 2 weeks there, I was told.
Okay. And what happened after that, like, after those 2 weeks?
Then when I got better and more healthy, I was taken to an orphanage.
Okay.
And then they put out, like, flyers in the local newspapers and ads for that I was abandoned if any biological family would come find me, mm-hmm. but nobody ever came.
No.
Because I went there 2 years ago, and that's how I found all this out.
Wow. Mm. So you were adopted, correct? By who were you adopted by? Family and?
It was a couple from Mandan, just okay. across the river.
Yeah. That's
my
awesome.
Adopted mom was actually out there.
Oh, that's awesome. Thank you for being here. So how was your experience growing up?
It was a little troubling.
Very troubling?
Yes.
What was troubling about it?
Well, my adopted father was an alcoholic, and he spent most of his time drinking in the bars. And
mm-hmm. I remember you saying your mom was the one who was at work most of the time?
Correct.
And so you were at home with your father?
Yes.
Correct? Okay. And was that was a pretty hard experience?
Yeah, seeing him drunk all the time, and could never like trust him or open up to him, or pretty much avoided him. Yeah.
Yeah, and do you want to explain a little bit more about was there things that happened with your dad at an early age that kind of drew you apart from him?
A lot of the drunken rages and never being there for me and forgetting me places and things like that. And
yeah, totally. So just a harm. So growing up, you went off to high school. How long did that last? How long did that season of hardship with your father last? Being home alone with him?
Pretty much most of my childhood till middle school, or I think early high school.
Early high school?
Yeah.
Okay. And what changed? How did that circumstance change?
Him and my mother got a divorce, and then he moved out. And
so you're at home with your mom?
Correct.
And did things get any better from there? How were things after that happened?
It improved a lot with my mom, yeah.
That's awesome.
We got closer.
That's great. How was your high school experience?
I guess because of my childhood experiences, I was really quiet and withdrawn, and I didn't have a whole lot of friends, and so I kind of just stuck to myself, and not through my own choice a whole lot, but I was a loner thinking I wasn't good enough, or I didn't have a lot of self-worth or anything like that. And
totally. Go ahead.
I was going to say, it was a pretty rough time for me.
Yeah, it sounds like it. Did you have any friends in high school that you really connected with?
There were people I kind of hung out with from time to time, but I wouldn't say like.
Gotcha. And then can you tell a little bit about like your spiritual background? Where'd you come from? How'd you grow up?
Catholic, Roman Catholic.
Okay. Gotcha. And was it when you went off to college that you started seeking different things out, or what brought the change?
I went into the military. I joined the Air Force shortly after high school, about a year after high school. And I came across a group of Muslims, and I was starting to teach them English, and I really noticed how they were so integrated with their faith and with all their prayers and how spiritual they were, and that really intrigued me, and so I wanted to know more about that.
Totally. So that actually drew you away from your Catholic faith, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. And so when you started learning more about that, did that convince you to, become a Muslim?
It did.
Yeah?
After a lot of questioning, and I'd ask some questions about what the Catholics believe, and they couldn't answer it, and they all seemed so intense with their faith, and so I asked them how I could become a Muslim, and they guided me through it.
So how did that change? Like, what was the difference? What did you find the differences between, so you were a Catholic, and then you became a Muslim, but what changed from there, and what were you seeking?
Well, my whole life I never really had any true identity. I didn't feel any sense of self-worth from being abandoned as a baby and then growing up with an alcoholic father. It was like I didn't know who I was, I guess, so I didn't really know how to open up to other people and how to relate to anyone. And I knew in my heart of hearts there was a true God and I could have a relationship with him. I just didn't know how to do that or how to go about it.
Right.
But then when I saw the Muslims and how they were so integrated with their faith and their prayers and their spirituality, I thought, this is it. I finally found it. And so.
Yeah. So what brought you out of Islam, the Islam faith?
Well, on the surface, it's really, like I just said, integrated into their faith. But also it's a lot of just rules and regulations. There's no true relationship like I was hoping for, and it seemed really hollow and empty. And there just wasn't nothing in there for me other than following some rules and hoping you're good enough to get to heaven someday. And I needed more than that out of God.
Right. So from there, you met those Muslims. Where'd you go next?
Well, I was in the Air Force, and I took a 3-year position in England. I was about an hour outside of London, and there were some other fellow soldiers that were practicing Hinduism. And I talked with them, and they told me that Hinduism is the way to go. So I didn't fully give up on Islam, but I started studying more Hinduism.
So you kind of both at the same time?
Yes.
Wow. And how did that go, studying Hinduism?
Kind of seemed like Islam. At the first, it was really everything I wanted, and I was really gung-ho about it. Mm-hmm. And I even went to India for, I think about a month or so. I was in India studying Hinduism and Muslim, or Islam. And it was the same thing as Islam, though. It was just rules and regulations, and there was, I mean, there's in Hinduism, there's 3 million gods, and yet you can't have a personal relationship with any one of those. And so I still wasn't what I was looking for.
Yeah.
So I quickly gave up on that.
So, okay, so no Islam and no Hinduism, but then where'd you go from there? What was the next thing? What were you seeking? What was the next thing you were seeking?
Well, when I was in India, the main religion there is, apart from Hinduism, is Buddhism. So I started searching Buddhism and seeing if that was the way to go. Because in Buddhism, there is no God. Like, you're your own God, and you're seeking nirvana and enlightenment with the universe.
Right.
And that's, in a sense, what I was seeking, but still.
Now, I remember you talking to me a little bit about, like, sweat houses. Can you explain that, and, like, what you kind of experienced in that, or what they did in that?
Yeah, you go in these, like, lodges, and there's a whole bunch of incense and, a fire in the middle, so it's really hot, and you're just sweating, and just wearing, like, really loose clothing. And then I think through the incense, you start, like, hallucinating. You're supposed to achieve enlightenment with those. But really, I think in a sense, you're just getting, like, kind of high, and then you're hallucinating. And
right.
And they think that they're seeking their gods or their enlightenment. But in reality, I believe it's demons. Because sometimes you'll see people, like, levitating or floating.
Yeah.
And I think that's more so, like, demons interacting with them. And
right. So obviously you're not a Buddhist because you're sitting here right
Correct.
Now.
Correct. Yeah, so, that didn't work out either.
So how did that happen? How did that transition happen? Where'd you go from Buddhism?
Well, because at this time I was also in like my early 20s, so I was kind of in the party mode. Not that I really ever drank or anything because of my father's drinking,
right.
But I was really into the heavy metal music, and that got me into like the satanic, like the Wiccan and devil worship. And in London, I had gone to several like Wiccan festivals, witch festivals, and mm-hmm. Satan rituals.
So what are some of the things that you've experienced there? And what did you do? What exactly did you do?
One of the main things they do, apart from the hardcore music, what called seances, where they use the Ouija boards and they try to summon up the dead, like dead relatives. And they think that the dead relatives can help them, like in the afterlife or something, and it's one of the scariest things I've ever done in my life, experiencing some of those. And
does that experience haunt you today still?
It does.
Yeah.
Because I think even till this day, some of those demons still follow, and still have some nightmares and trouble sleeping. And
I remember you saying you knew in your heart that it was wrong, yet you continued to do it.
Correct.
And that's crazy to me. But At some point in your life, you had to know that it was wrong enough to stop, or at least, correct?
That's right.
Okay. So what happened after you stopped participating in these festivals?
I gave up on all religions.
Yeah? Just came to a point saying there is no God?
Well, not that I was an atheist, but it just seemed like, because I was doing all these things to search for God, and I couldn't find him anywhere in all these religions, and I'd been to Saudi Arabia, been to India, and I couldn't find him anywhere, so I pretty much just gave up on him. And I thought if, you know, he didn't want me, I guess I won't continue to find him, so I just gave up on everything. And
it's crazy. I remember you saying, my birth parents didn't want me, my adopted dad didn't want me, and now God doesn't even want me.
Correct.
And I can't even imagine just being in that place of literally hopelessness in a way.
It was.
God changed your life dramatically, and I kind of want to get into that.
Sure.
And so, what was it, 2 years later, you went to school and learned about what branch was it in the military that you signed up for?
U.S. Army.
Okay. And you went into the armory, and you went into the most dangerous countries, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
That's me out there.
Okay.
I was a SAW gunner in Iraq as part of the invasion in 2003.
Okay, and that was from going to Kuwait into...
Into Iraq.
Iraq, okay.
Following the Marines.
Right. And so you're at the top of the SAW gunner.
Correct.
Okay.
I'm the number one that they shoot at and that I shoot. Yeah. That was me. I was the...
Pretty scary experience.
It was terrifying, yeah.
Yeah.
To say the least.
So I think a lot of times people ask this question, and have you seen some of your friends and your platoon mates get killed in battle?
Not directly from my battalion, but I did witness a lot of other soldiers, other SAW gunners and other units that were killed. And mm-hmm.
And you had friends in the field that died?
Correct. People that, because you get really close to these people when you're all in the battlefield, and sometimes you're sleeping in the same vehicles. And
So take us to that place, to Kuwait. And you are on the front lines, about to go into a live combat, correct? And what happened in that experience?
Well, up to this point, I was still seeking God, even though not actively like I had been, but I still knew I needed to find him and that he was the only one that would give me the hope I needed. And now going into battle, I was even more terrified because, you know, there's a pretty good chance we could die once we got across the border there. And the army chaplain had given me a Bible, mm-hmm. and I opened it up, and the first thing I came to was John 14:6. That's it right there. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." And for like a split second, my heart stopped because... like all these religions, the Muslim, the Hinduism, the Buddhism, the Satanism, I was searching for all those things. And here Jesus tells me all in one that he's those things.
And no other religions told you?
No other gods. Like I said, in Hinduism, there's 3 million gods. They don't say that. Buddha doesn't say that. Allah doesn't say that.
That's amazing.
Only Jesus.
So that was the start. That was the first seed that kind of came in that really started to change your life. Okay?
That's right.
So you had a friend named Tony. Right before you're about to go into battle, can you tell us about that experience?
He was a fellow SAW gunner like I was, and we were in the same battalion but different companies. I was Bravo Company, and he was Alpha Company. And so we were lined up right next to each other, and I looked over and I saw him reading the Bible. And this is right on the border of Iraq and Kuwait, so we were waiting any moment just to enter into Iraq. And we were, of course, terrified because... there had been people in my unit that were former Navy SEALs, mm-hmm. Army Rangers, and these people were really freaking out because we didn't know what to expect once we crossed that border and if we were going to come back home alive or not.
Right.
And this Tony, who had never been in combat either, like myself, he was so calm and cool, and he wasn't the least bit freaking out or worried. And so I said, "What's going to happen if we go across that border and we die?" And he told me, "I know as a matter of fact in my heart of hearts that I will be with Jesus for all eternity." And that was the second time my heart stopped, because that's what I needed to hear at that time. And
so what did Tony do?
He jumped out of his Humvee and up onto mine, and he prayed with me. And then he showed me Revelations 3:20, which is up there. And that's Jesus speaking. And he says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone opens the door and hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and will sup or eat with him and he with me." Mm-hmm. And all these searching that I had been doing, all these other religions, to me that was Jesus knocking, but I was opening the wrong doors. And
totally. And he explained to you how to have a personal relationship with Christ.
And I had briefly told him all the different religions I had tried, and they were all failures. And he said, "What I'm doing is introducing you to your own personal relationship with Jesus, not another religion." And that's exactly what I needed to hear also. And so I opened the door, and I heard Jesus' voice, and I let him in.
Yeah. And you said he also mentioned another passage, correct? I think it was Romans?
Romans 10:9.
Yeah.
It says, "If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved."
And you knew at that moment
I believed,
that you believed. And it's crazy because I look at this story and I ask, like, how did you get here? How did you get back to Bismarck? So you knew, like, from there, You went, and then what happened? You had 30 seconds?
Yeah, then after that, Tony hopped back over to his Humvee on top of it because he was another SOG gunner. And literally 30 seconds later, the sirens went off, and the Marines moved in, and then shortly after that, maybe 10 minutes later, we moved in. And then because we were in different companies, Tony went one way and I went the other.
Hmm. And did you end up meeting him again?
We did about a month or so later.
Both survived.
Yep. We met up in Baghdad, actually, when we helped take over the airport. And
that's crazy. And so did you come back to Bismarck after the war?
I did.
Okay. And how'd you get connected here at Charity?
It wasn't immediately, but a year or so later, maybe a few years later, a fellow coworker told me about the Wednesday WOW, and I really enjoyed that, and then I started coming on Sundays, and now the Sunday night WOW. And
that's absolutely amazing. So just in summary, I kind of want to summarize this because this is crazy. So you were almost abandoned as a child, and to the point of you had an alcoholic father who didn't want you, and you just sought to want to be loved by God, and you felt like you had to earn your way.
Correct.
And so you tried every, like, a lot of different religions.
All the major world ones, yeah.
Right, to try to get to him.
Yes.
And it wasn't enough.
No.
Until you met Jesus.
Correct.
That's amazing. And now God has brought you here and is using your story to encourage the other people around who might be struggling or dealing with
some sort of suffering, yeah.
Absolutely. I look at your past and I think of, wow, that's a lot of suffering. But because of the suffering, I just look at your story and say, God has totally changed your life. God is totally working on you. And he doesn't give up on you, does he?
He doesn't. And through all the suffering, it seems like he's nowhere to be found, but actually he's right there with you, guiding you through it. And I realize that later now. So for anyone who is going through suffering, he is there with you and he will bring you through it.
Amen. Amen. Well, we're about out of time, but I just want to say thanks, Donovan, for being here. Thanks for sharing your story.
Thank you for listening.
Courage, so.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You got great blessing over this man.
Yeah, we do. Yeah. Let's do it.
Thank you, you too.
Thank you, Heather. That was a great idea.
Thank you, yeah.
If you guys would please join me in just raising your hand as a blessing over Donovan, that'd be awesome. Dear Lord, we just thank you for Donovan. We thank you for his story. We thank you for what you brought him through. And Lord, that in the midst of his suffering, in the midst of his pain, in the midst of his sadness, that he knows that you were there. And Lord, his story is here to remind us that even though, no matter what we're going through, no matter what our circumstances, our situations are, that you are here with us, Lord. And so, Lord, thank you for him. And I just pray your protection over him. I pray your protection over his heart, over his mind. I just pray, Lord Jesus, that he would continue to share his story, that he would continue to say, you know what, I have the courage because of Christ in me. And Lord, that you would show him every single day that you are the God that heals him. You are the God that forgives his sins. You are the God that walks with him each moment. And that he has that personal relationship with you. That your friendship is a friendship that will never die. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you again,
Doctor. Thank you. Thanks, Dad.